Good morning. We are the second talk. If you're trying to count the mentions of AI, good luck. We're here to talk about it some more. Michael, Nicole, thanks for being here.
Thanks, Alex. I
thought we should maybe just start kind of big picture for the both of you, and Lightspeed is a fun, but you know, covering the space, covering consumer and generative AI, there is just so much happening. There's so many deals, so many new companies. It's exciting to cover. It's frankly feels daunting as well. I imagine as an investor, there's a similar feeling there. But how do the both of you and Lightspeed think about just evaluating everything out there? It's frankly a lot of hot air. There's a lot of interesting founders too. But how do you look at that from both of your positions and from the fund?
Yeah, I think on the consumer side, it's pretty simple, and I think it's something that maybe people have kind of forgotten about over the past year, and that is really looking at great products, right? I mean, if you look at the past year, there's been so much investment in infrastructure, in models, which makes sense, right? Any technological shift, there's going to be this upfront investment in infra. And I think that's what last year was in many ways about. But now I think we're starting to see the products. We're starting to see the application layer. And at the end of the day, like, that's what customers are engaging with. That's what customers are paying for. That's what this is all about. And so I think there's going to be a big renewed focus, and this is definitely how we're thinking about it on the consumer side, in the products. And I think through that lens, consumer as a whole, and as you mentioned, Nicole and I are both focused on consumer, it feels like consumer is going to have sort of this massive tailwind behind it moving forward. You know, AI, the way we actually often talk a lot about AI is it's almost like units of work and units of intelligence. And if you can put those units of work to work for you and do the things that you don't want to do, right, that frees up all your time to do the things you do want to do, be entertained, invest in health, invest in wellness. So I think consumer as a category and really great products in consumer are really going to have a massive tailwind behind them now.
I love this idea of units of time. In our consumer meetings at Lightspeed, we often will talk about it in terms of, it's like one day you've woken up and won the lottery, but not of money, it's the lottery of time. And so if you're usually spending 5 hours a day writing a newsletter, you can use Beehive to write the newsletter for you with their AI product. And then you have, what, 5 hours left in your day that you can spend on what you want to do. And so with this lottery of time that we're all going to get back, how are we going to spend it? Are we going to spend it on entertainment, on travel? And then AI will then be able to expand all of those different categories as well. And so we often, with any technological wave, we've found that on the application layer, it generally starts with entertainment, companionship, escapism, as you say, which I love. And then once it reaches critical mass, at that point, you then move to the more utility sides of applications. And so you go to an AI financial manager, or an AI interior designer, or a travel planner. And that's where we get really excited. And so when we're sifting through, that's when we get excited.
I imagine a conversation that will be kind of had a lot over the next couple of days is where value is accruing in the stack. So if you think about the foundational models, the app layer, like we've been talking about, I'm of the opinion, I feel like it's becoming increasingly thought of this way, that the foundational model layer is becoming increasingly commoditized, costs coming down, rise of open source. How does that affect the consumer app layer? How do those two things intersect, and where does value accrue over time?
Yeah, I mean, I think as open source rises and it becomes easier and easier to train models and create applications, I think you're going to see just this massive long tail of new experiences. But I also think that we've seen over the past year that there's just been a tremendous amount of value accrued to the products and companies that vertically integrate both a model and a product, mm-hmm. right? And so if you think about the two biggest winners of the past year, they've really been these consumer products that have vertically integrated a model and a product. I'm talking about ChatGPT, right? Rumored to be doing something like $2 billion in annual revenue off ChatGPT, and Midjourney, right, which is doing, you know, I read something like hundreds of millions in ARR. So the thing, the power of those two things is there's a feedback loop between the model and the product. And so, you know, I think those types of companies are very, very exciting. But at the same time, again, I think we're going to see this new long tail of experiences emerge due to the breakout of open source.
And Nicole, you work a lot with celebrities, artists, creatives. There's this idea that AI is going to help a creator, an influencer, have infinite versions of themselves that can interact with all their fans. You're involved with House, Lady Gaga's company, speaking later today. What are your conversations like with the artists and celebs and creators that you talk to all the time as it relates to AI? How is that intersecting?
So I feel like the easy answer is that if you think about celebrities, it will first help them and then it will replace them. That is one view. We very much disagree with that. We do not see in any way AI replacing what's happening in Hollywood. Instead, we see AI really doing two things. One, vastly increasing the user experience, and two, building new business models. So now, what is an example of that? Well, over the last couple of technological waves, what you've really seen is consumers pay for influencers and celebrities creating content, whether that be through movies or through Instagram. The consumer pays. But what is new with AI is you are seeing celebrities, influencers actually pay to create this content. And so, you know, whether it be Midjourney or Notion or Beehive, I think it's really exciting to see how much, I mean, how high the willingness to pay is for creators to actually come in and pay to create this content and have it just vastly better, as well as the consumers also paying. So I think that we're just going to see much larger dollars in this space as a result.
I think this is actually a really interesting point. You know, if you think about media, the category of media and creativity over the past couple of decades on the internet, the business model has always been focused on the consumption side, right? Monetizing, you know, subscription to content or ads. But I think to your point, you have this new dynamic playing out where creators recognize the value of the AI and they're willing to pay for it. So I think we might see these new businesses emerge where literally both sides of the platform, the creation and the consumption, are being monetized.
What other business models are there? I mean, is advertising come into play here? I mean, you've got like Meta doing and Google doing it in pretty much every way. They're putting AI in everything. Just how big of a business can be built right now, I guess, at the app layer? Is it really just about charging people to use the model and use the product? Is there more there?
Well, again, I think there can be two things. I think there can be charging to use the model and the product, and that can happen either via subscription or buying individual credits. But then again, I think you can have monetization on the other side as it's traditionally been through ads or through subscription to consume content.
Should VCs be funding these massive GPU buildouts that these companies are doing? It seems like there's differing views on this. GPUs prices are going to come down. What's your advice when you're talking to a founder about this? And I want to get into kind of how the strategics and the big cloud platforms are maybe distorting the space a little bit and making it maybe harder or easier. I don't know, depending on how you look at it for you guys. But how do you think about those kind of rounds?
Yeah. You want me to?
I'll start it off.
Sure.
We had a really great pre-discussion on this topic, and we actually want to go into the more controversial side of this. So I'd say, like, with valuations right now, in the seed side, seed is just generally an idea. And then we're seeing, like, big Series A's be done, which is just an idea, and maybe there's, like, an early product there. And then Series B's are when you've got, like, maybe a tiny bit of traction. And so we're really seeing such high valuations. I mean, Character is a good example of one where, you know, it was such early days where they raised at a $1 billion valuation. And then you're right. Like, you need to come in and you need to be thinking about these, you know, compute deals. It doesn't make sense for VCs to be paying the same as a Google, for example. If a Google is giving you $100 million, they don't care about the valuation because that's just coming straight back to them in the compute deal. And so VCs need to be very strict with regards to, hey, this is not good for the business for you to be doing this. And I'm going to hand to Mike because he has some more in-depth thoughts.
Yeah, no, I totally agree with what you just said. I mean, I think our job as VCs are to help our founders and our entrepreneurs get the capital they need for the things they need to spend it on, right? And they need GPUs, right? They need compute. The strategics that are helping fund a lot of compute and these compute deals you talk about, I think they're obviously seeing the same need and they recognize that they have supply that can meet that demand. I think to your point, the thing that founders probably just need to be mindful of is that the incentives are not really the same, right? The incentive of a strategic that's investing for compute is really to generate revenue, right, for the compute. Whereas I think VC, traditional venture, the incentives try to be as aligned as possible for upside in the actual business. And so I think that can potentially lead to distortions in valuations.
Which is good for markups on one end, but like not good maybe long term.
Yeah, really, it's got to be about value, right?
Yeah.
Long term value. And that's what's good for the entrepreneur, too. But the valuation, especially if it's distorted because the incentives are misaligned from the strategic, could actually create a lot of problems for that entrepreneur down the line.
Yeah. Maybe this is just the journalist in me, but I am increasingly becoming convinced that there's a ticking time bomb under a lot of these companies, which is the copyright problem around training data. And you've had some firms, you know, make comments to government agencies basically saying valuations go to zero if law passes that this kind of training is violating copyright. What's your all's view on that? What are you talking to your companies about as it relates to training data and copyright?
I think it's a wild west right now. I think it's obviously a gray area, and I think startups are racing to take advantage of that gray area, which, by the way, is the same thing that happens every time there's a new technology that operates in somewhat of a gray area. I do think, though, that companies, both startups and incumbents, are hedging for a potential eventual future where the laws do change around training data and what data you can ingest to train your model. And I think for proof of this, just look at a lot of these new content deals that are happening, right? We're seeing OpenAI do deals with Axel Springer, and obviously there's the New York Times lawsuit. We'll see what happens there. You know, just the other day, I think there was a deal announced between Reddit and Google. And
yeah.
So it feels like companies are both still sucking in as much publicly scrapable data as possible while also hedging their bets. Because I think there's a chance that it might end up playing out somewhat similar to kind of how M&A is playing out right now, right? You have countries and parts of the world that are maybe a little bit more lenient and less conservative about M&A. But if you operate in a country that is really, really conservative and wants to block a deal, that affects you. And I think the same thing could happen here, right? If you're training off of publicly scrapable data, but you operate in a country that now wants to make that illegal, you're going to have to comply. And so I think the big takeaway is getting access to unique and proprietary data.
How do you do that as a startup, though? Because that's the problem, right? You're starting from scratch. How do you build that flywheel to get that data?
Yeah, I mean, do you want to take that or me? I mean, I think it's, here's the thing, like startups have always had to compete with incumbents who have more capital, more engineers, more resources. And I think the best startups and the best founders find a way to crack distribution, to reach new user types, to create network effects. And I think it's gonna take the same type of ingenuity and creativity to unlock these new data sources that are untapped.
Is hardware a new distribution in terms of consumer hardware? Is that something you guys look at? There's a lot of interesting stuff. You got Rabbit, Humane, all these interesting wearable companies.
We have definitely been spending a lot of time looking at hardware. 10 years ago, the way I actually met Lightspeed was because I had a hardware business, and I pitched it to them as a founder. And I have to say, like, it was really tough running that business because the very next year, Apple came out with the Apple Watch, and then after that, all the Chinese folks were doing it at a fraction of the price. And so I am definitely scarred from that experience personally. But so when we look at all the new hardware, I am optimistic, I am hopeful, because as I think about, yes, we have a new technological wave of AI. On top of that, if we then have the AI app store, and then on top of that, you have new hardware, well, that is when it gets really, really exciting, when those three things collide together. That is when I think we're going to have some really exciting opportunities on the application side of things. But will we get consumer adoption of the hardware? I mean, Rabbit's really cool. We spend a lot of time with Humane. And I want that to work. It's just that I feel like it needs to right now work in conjunction with the phone. Because if not, then, you know, are you all willing to just move over entirely to a new device? And so will it come from Apple, Facebook? It does feel like they are definitely at an advantage. So probably the incumbents might win on the hardware race, but I'm really hopeful that there is new hardware because then the application layer gets really exciting.
Yeah, is there like a cart before the horse thing playing out here? Or maybe it's just really early and a lot of excitement, but I think about like Siri still can't correctly text the right person. And it's like once they update that, what happens to all of these wearable, you know, voice controlled companies, right? Once Siri actually has an LLM in it that works, which I think will happen potentially later this year. Yeah, does that change? Does that, it sounds like that threat potentially makes you more cautious about consumer hardware? Is that fair?
To me, the operative part of that sentence is like later this year. I feel like if you think about Siri, if you think about Alexa, they have come such a long way just in the last couple of years. I mean, think about how basic it was and how many mistakes it was making back then. So they do have some of their smartest minds working on these products. And I think later this year, it will be good enough. It nearly already is. And so, yes, when, not if, they come out with their hardware for AI, I am in the camp of the incumbents winning on that side of things, but definitely open-minded to an exceptional founder building there. But we just need to see that cross the chasm.
I think we might also see brand new experiences at the application layer that take advantage of hardware, maybe even existing hardware, right? Like AirPods or watches or glasses.
Right.
When new back to your data question, when new types of data get fed into these models, right? I think the Meta Ray-Ban glasses are a perfect example, right? Yeah. All of a sudden, there's a new input mechanism to feed into a model that can create a brand new experience that didn't exist before. So I also think we might see some really interesting things at the application layer as a result of the intersection of AI and hardware.
Yeah, kind of on competition, you've got Pika as one of your companies, which is doing a lot of really interesting video generation. OpenAI just demoed Sora. There's a lot of activity in generating video right now. How do you think about the competitive space and how it's all going to shake out? It seems still pretty early. Like, you know, they don't get really physics yet. It's getting rapidly better though. So it feels like maybe in like a year or two, we're making movies this way. I don't know. How do you feel about that?
It's accelerating very, very quickly. The Sora announcement was obviously awesome. The sample videos are incredible. Great marketing campaign. The product is not available yet.
It's clearly hindered by compute, right? I mean, you can only do a minute or something. It's like, that seems to be the gating factor for video right now.
Yeah. So all credit in the world, obviously, to OpenAI and Sora. But the reality is that the architectural approach to Sora is actually not the differentiator thing here. It's the compute and it's the data. And so not to just hype our book and hype Pika, but you know, they're actually working on an approach that we expect will exceed Sora. In the not too distant future, because again, it's not about the architectural approach; it's about the data and the compute. And the other thing that we see is specialization really matters, right? OpenAI came out with Whisper 2 years ago, right? And I think everyone thought that would just sort of decimate the voice landscape. But what we've seen is that specialization and verticalization and focus on a specific product that takes advantage of that model is the winning approach. And that's why 11 Labs just continues to soar and accelerate. And that's really what Pika's doing. I think Pika has this viewpoint that it's gotta be about more than just a prompt, right? You can't make a Hollywood film as a consumer with just a prompt.
Right.
You need product that actually creates a feedback loop between the model and the product to do something really, really special. And that's what Pika's doing. They're also just like the most talented, exceptional engineers in this category. And they actually just hired the first author of Google Lumiere. So they're attracting all the best talent. So we're really, really excited about Pika.
Maybe we can end on this, just kind of how people are actually using these agents, these AI chatbots in their daily lives. I go on like the character AI subreddit and it's like people falling in love. They get mad when the models get tuned because it's like your girlfriend broke up with you. People are really, in an almost kind of scary way, or it could be dystopian how you look at it, but people are just spending increasing amount of times talking to these chatbots. Nicole, what do you think about that? Like, where does this end up? Is this like the path to WALL-E that we're on right now?
So at Lightspeed, we love to invest where there's an existing human behavior and a technology overlay. And what you're talking about is human behavior. And we often see this at the beginning of every single technological wave, the companionship, the entertainment side of things, and that is no different here. And you are right. Like, if we look at the engagement data, folks are spending more than an hour a day on character. And the DAO-MAO ratio is better than we've seen since Snapchat. And so it really is very exciting. And it is just allowing people to tap into what they want to, what they have been using. But we do believe that the next layer, which we're particularly excited about, will be more on the utility side of things. And so we spent so much time in this conversation talking about AI-first companies, but it's also the AI-adjacent companies that are really going to be making great change right now. And so Beehive, for example, is one where, you know, just 6 months ago, they put in their new AI, and the business is more than 10x as a result of that. It's a newsletter business for enterprises, SMBs, influencers. And so people are really able to go in there and create their own content, and yeah, they can, you know, create great things where they can speak to one another on it. But it really is a far better experience because of that AI. And so we're going to see a lot more in terms of these AI first and adjacent businesses. But I think companionship is just the start.
All right. We're going to have to leave it there. Thank you, guys.
Thanks, Alex.
Thank you, Alex.